So last time, took our diffusivity equation, and we discretized the derivatives, right? We used the forward approximation for the first derivative in time, and the central difference approximation for the second derivative in space. And then we made the decision to evaluate the right-hand side at the time in, right? So at the old time. And then we solve the equation for the new time, the n plus 1 time, and we resulted in this, right? After solving for the new time, the n plus 1 time. Right. So that's sort of the last equation from the last class. We called this the explicit method. And it turns out that this thing right here, it's going to appear in a lot of our equations, and I don't want to write it over and over, so we're just going to define that to be eta. And it's a dimensionless parameter. So if you worked out the units, you'd see that it's dimensionless. So remember, I said, you know, we call it explicit because we're writing down the new pressure plainly in terms of all the old pressures. So just to be explicit about the explicit method, let's write out a couple of time steps to just get a flow, just to get a feel for how it flows, right? And again, we're going to write out some time steps for any I grid block. So we'll leave it in the generic. We'll leave the spatial terms generic, right? So this may be a little bit too simple here, but right, so if I choose n to be 0, right, you choose n to be 0, then on the left-hand side, then that superscript is going to evaluate to 1. So everything on the right-hand side, all those zero superscripts, those are assumed to be known. That's at the beginning of time or at the beginning of the simulation, right? So those are our initial conditions. Okay? So with our initial conditions, we can evaluate the next increment in time. So then we'll just take another step. So n will be equal to 1. Okay, so we'd solve this equation. Now we know P1i, and we can plug it in into the second equation, and we know P2i, and we just keep going. Dot, 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 until, you know, eventually let's say we're going to run our simulation for 100 iterations, max. So that's the end, right? So then, so everybody see how that works? Now, in a little while, I'm going to show you the implicit method, and you're going to see it's much sort of more difficult. But you might ask, well, why would we ever do that? This is so simple. And the caveat is that in this method, for it to be stable, eta has to be less than a half. So when we're talking about numerical stability, what we mean is that the errors don't, if it's stable, the errors won't grow without bound. Right. And I mean, you're going to code this up later in a week or two, and you can just try it. Just see what happens when you make eta too large. The errors will just grow without bound, and the simulation will blow up. When we say blow up in numerics, it means like the numbers get too large or too small, and you get NANDs, right? Not a numbers everywhere. So